African states from the colonialists 60 years ago, there was a need to found the Organization of African Unity, or the African Union, as it was then renamed in 2002. These issues have been happening for many years, and of course, on the 20th of May, 25th May 1963, the foundation of this organization was actually established in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia. And 32 African member states then had achieved their independence and therefore became members of that organization. It had goals and certainly aspirations of the Africa that they wanted to see. The forefathers of the African continent, or the independent Africa, had a vision and had aspirations for this continent. We want to see and reflect on the 60 years of this organization and what has been achieved, what was intended, and what is still lacking. This is going to shape our conversation this morning. My guest is Major Retired David Rusa, and of course the former director at the External Security Organization. We want to have a conversation and have a review of this organization. Was it even necessary to have this organization founded? Major, thank you so much for joining me this morning.
Thank you, Mubarak.
Let's start with that question. Was it necessary to have this organization
founded? Was it necessary? Or maybe before we answer, was it necessary? What happened before then? It is not lost on many people that a lot of attempts were made to free Africa, first of all, from colonialism. But even before that, a lot of African, people of African descent, especially in the diaspora, those Africans who were in the Americas and Europe, had come together with the sole aim of freeing Africa from a number of things. One was physical occupation, colonial occupation. Two was exploitation. Three was racial inequality, especially for those who were living outside Africa. Four was the whole whole attitude of other people towards the black race. It was as if being an African was a curse. Sometimes even some people tried to use religious literature to show that Africans were an inferior race. Some said Africans are grandchildren of Ham, and in the Bible, those of us who are Christians, Ham, I think, was a son of Noah, who was cursed. So now when you say the Africans are descendants of a man who was cursed, the whole message was to distort.
It was a racist message.
Very racist. And yet, when you study, even from the Bible and from history, Christianity came to Africa before it went to any other continent, by the way, apart from the Middle East. The first continent that Christianity came to was Africa, Egypt, to be precise. And then Ethiopia, these churches in Ethiopia and Egypt, the Coptic Church, they are very old churches. And then Islam. Islam came to Africa in 641, the first time, Egypt, and spread. So that's why I don't agree with people who keep saying Christianity and Islam are foreign religions. No, they are not. In fact, I can say, Africans had religion, this Christianity and Islam, for that matter, long before the Europeans. And then coming now.
To 1963.
To the 1900s, there were the Pan-Africanist movements. First of all, in London, in 1900. You know, many of these Africans who went to study in Europe and America, decided to come together. It is again a long story of William Du Bois, who was the founder of the Pan-Africanist movement. And then we had Marcus Garvey, who was also a very active member, who were later on joined by Africans from Africa, like Kwame Nkrumah, Jomo Kenyatta. And we had our own Prince Dr. Chiki Nyabongo from Toro. She was a great Pan-Africanist. Almost all those Africans who were there was, of course, Dr. Namdi Azikiwe and others from Nigeria and others. And then there was Leopold Seda Senghor and his theory of negritude. I don't know whether you have ever heard of negritude. Yeah. Negritude was a reaction. Black is beautiful. Trying to make things black look good on the world stage. And that was the way Leopold Seda Senghor looked at it. Although, paradoxically, he was a member of the French House of Deputies. Now, I don't know how you reconcile those, but somehow at least he tried to play the African card. Now, as a result of these Pan-Africanist movements, and I would say, especially the one of Manchester in 1945, played a very big role. And remember, this was when the Second World War was ending. So this one played a very big role in awakening the world to the need for decolonization. Of course, India was the first among the big countries to decolonize. And then there is another factor which people don't talk much about, that decolonization. Nobody talks about the role of the USA in decolonization. Of course, now we look at the USA siding with their teeth and kin, but they are among those factors that facilitated decolonization. And you may ask how and why. After the Second World War, Europe was totally bankrupt and needed help, which came in form of what was called the Marshall Plan. Marshall was the US Secretary of State, general, I think he was a general. And
yeah, he was a general.
He, as Secretary of State, proposed a grand plan to rescue Europe from the another Great Depression after the Second World War. However, this help did not come without strings. Don't think these strings are only given to us. The United States imposed conditions on Europe that you are getting this aid from us, yes, you are going to reconstruct, but you must open the colonies to us. And the only way you could open the colonies...
Not for the African interests, but also for them to have an interest.
Well, obviously not for African interests, yes. For their own interests. But then in the process, we gained independence because the US wanted the colonies opened so that the Americans could access the colonial markets. And so, independence came. Now, of course, it took different forms. Some countries negotiated.
Others fought.
Others, like Kenya, the Mau Mau fought from 1952 to 1960. The former Portuguese colonies, Angola, Mozambique, Guinea-Bissau, fought for over 10 years. South Africa, it was a protracted struggle right from 1912, when the African National Congress was formed.
They must have been the longest.
Yes, up to 1994.
Yeah.
Then you had Rhodesia, or what is Zimbabwe today? Yeah, those were some of the violent. Algeria, of course, that one was also a violent struggle. Algeria against the French, with Ben Bella and others. And that is where now this man called Frantz Fanon, who wrote the famous book, The Wretched of the Earth. He was involved in that Algerian War of Independence. And Algeria became independent in 1960, 60, 61, I think. And it was because of the Algerian independence caused the ripples in France, because the French were so bitter that they lost Algeria. Now, French controlled a number of countries, of course, especially North and West Africa. And then one thing we need to note is that when the French were granting independence, it was not without conditions. In fact, these countries were granted independence almost a conditional independence. Of course, we don't have the time to go there. But when you study the disengagement of France from Africa, there were so many conditionalities that you may not trade with another power without French sanctioning, you may not buy arms from other powers, you will trade with France as a prior, a lot of things. However, one country refused all that, and that was Guinea under Sékou Touré, Guinea-Conakry, under Ahmed Sékou Touré. And as a consequence of that, the French almost uprooted everything, including electric poles. They wanted to turn Guinea into a pre-colonial country where everything done by the French must be destroyed. Of course, this was oblivious of the fact that the French had got a lot of things from Guinea. Well, Guinea was on its knees. Fortunately, it was bailed out by an African brother, Ghana, under Kwame Nkrumah, which gave Guinea a loan of $50 million that settled Guinea. Now, I'm raising this because just before the formation of the OAU, there were two, I don't want to call them cliques, but there were two blocks.
Two tendencies.
Call them tendencies, yes, or even blocks, because there is one that was called the Casablanca Group, or groups, which included the radicals. And what did the radicals represent? The radicals wanted African Union now. Those were the radicals.
They wanted it now.
They wanted what they called the United States of Africa. The United States of Africa, with one government, one military high command, one foreign policy, you know, like all states. Now this was
fully integrated.
Fully integrated. This was the Casablanca Group, and it included the radicals. Who were the radicals? Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, Ahmed Sékou Touré, Ahmed Ben Bella, Gamal Abdel Nasser, King Mohammed V of Morocco, and King Idris of Libya. Although Idris was now, later on, he was hovering between the two. Now, these were the men who wanted African unity now. Now, and these came to be called the radicals. Now they were the realists, or those, some call them the gradualists. Those who looked at the realities on the ground and said, no, no.
We want this, African but we Union, may not achieve
in
it.
Fact, Mwalimu Nyerere was the spokesperson. He said, much as we desire for Africa to be a united continent under one government, one administration, it is a good ideal, but it's not attainable in the near future. We can only achieve this gradually through regional organizations, like, say, one in the north, one in the west, one in the east, one in the south, which would gradually
integrate
into one African Union. Now, because of these two tendencies, in fact, they were not so friendly, by the way. Actually, there were some contradictions, so much so that in 1960, when Togolese president Sylvanus Olympio was gunned down, it is said Kwame Nkrumah jubilated. Well, I wouldn't want to say, but it is said. Because Olympio was a conservative in Nkrumah. And the other conservatives were Alhaji Abakari Tafawa Balewa of Nigeria, and most of the African countries. Mm. But this these contradictions in Pan-African issues were not new. Even in the Pan-African movement, there were two tendencies. There was the radical tendency led by Marcus Garvey on what was called Back to Africa movement, where they were advocating for NMOS return to Africa of the African Americans, or Negroes as they were called then. That all must return to Africa. But then the question was, return to where?
So how did they reconcile the two tendencies?
Okay. This is what we saw. So when they came together to the Pan-African, you are talking of the Pan-African movement, now we are talking of the AU.
Right. How did they come to a conclusion to
so
say?
So I just wanted to
you had two tendencies.
Yes. Just some like they were in Pan-African movement between Marcus Garvey and Du Bois. Now, because of these conflicting tendencies, the Africa's elder statesman, Emperor Haile Selassie of Ethiopia, who was respected for many reasons. He had fought for his country against the Italians. Ethiopia was never colonized. And so, because of that respect, the emperor convened a meeting of all the tendencies, all the groups in Addis Ababa.
The radicals and the graduates.
The radicals and the non-radicals.
The liberals.
They would and be they liberals. All came together. And after several meetings and discussion, it was resolved to form a diluted continental organization with the aim of fostering unity, African unity, as the ultimate aim. But in the meantime, they had to have certain goals and objectives. The most urgent being the colonization of all the African countries that were still under colonialism.
Because then they were about 32?
Yeah, the founders of the AU were 32. Mm. Today they are 55.
Yeah.
Which means 23 were still
occupied.
Prominent among them, surprisingly, Kenya was still a colony.
That was 1963.
Yes, although it was about to get
it.
Zambia was still a colony. Malawi was still a colony.
Most of Southern Africa.
Most of Southern Africa, truly, yes. Plus the Angola, but still, those were also in Southern Africa. So all these countries which were still colonies. Now, the priority number one was that they decolonize
the entire continent.
Right. Number two was that Africa works towards, forms regional organizations which would foster African integration. These would be mainly economic groupings. In fact, you may wish to know that the first grouping to be formed in this category was the East African Community in 1967. East African Community had been there before. It kept on changing. It started as East African High Commission, then East African Common Services Organization, and then in 1967, 1st December actually, East African Community was formed, comprising of the original three East African countries, Kenya, Uganda, and Tanzania, with headquarters in Arusha. And then later on, other regional groupings were formed. ECOWAS, I think in 1975, Economic Community of West African States, I think in 1975, the Maghreb Union, you know, North Africa had problems because these leaders did not always agree. When Gaddafi took over in Libya, he was an enemy of King Hassan of Morocco, because he had overthrown King Idris. So the king was bitter that his little brother had been killed and overthrown and killed. So there was always a contradiction between Libya and Morocco. Even Libya and Egypt were not always the best of buddies. Algeria was kind of independent, but North Africa never formed any. Okay, Egypt at one time flirted with the idea of forming a union with Syria, what came to be called the United Arab Republic. I don't know whether you have ever heard of such a thing.
Never heard of it.
With Hafez al-Assad and Gamal Abdel Nasser, they attempted to form a union to fight Israel, but which was shattered in 1967, the Six-Day War. So
and the regional blocs were formed.
So the regional blocs which were formed were really two at the time. In fact, one maybe, because at the time of the formation of the ECOWAS, the East African community was disintegrating. The East African community, which was formed in 1967, got problems in 1971, when Idi Amin took over power in Uganda. Julius Nyerere refused to sit on the same table with Amin because he felt Amin had nothing to offer.
So the first the first aspiration was decolonize.
Decolonize.
Which was actually successful.
Which was being achieved.
Yes. Then the second
formation of regional groups. Blocks,
yes.
Which would act as facilitators
to the general
integration
of Africa.
Yes.
What is the another aspiration that was in there?
Economic development.
Which is still a process.
Economic development, that was a major one, to disengage from the colonial economy. Kwame Nkrumah had brought the theory of neocolonialism. You know, Nkrumah was a philosopher, taking on the Karl Marx, Lenin. So there was, at one time in Ghana, it was being called Maoist-Leninist Nkrumist. Now, Nkrumah, you know, Karl Marx talks of capitalism and how capitalism would collapse. In fact, Karl Marx had predicted that capitalism would collapse in 1870-71 in Europe. Now, capitalism didn't collapse. The question is why? Because the Europeans left Europe and went to other lands and colonized them. And so the colonization of other lands delayed or extended the collapse of capitalism. So Lenin, Vladimir Ilyich Lenin, the founder of the Soviet Union, had to give an explanation. And he wrote big treatise called Imperialism, the Last Stage of Capitalism. So Lenin explained why, in spite of Karl Marx's prediction, capitalism never collapsed. So he said it was propped up by imperialism. Because when the Europeans conquered territories in Africa, in Asia, they had already been in Latin America, then they got resources, they got markets, they got surplus labor, which propelled them. And so capitalism survived.
I want you to handle the question of this union or this unity, today African Union, is to many referred as a toothless organization.
Oh.
An organization that has never been seen
taking
critical issues.
Let's wait a bit. Can we wait a bit before we conclude on it? Because, okay. Now,
have you ever seen African Union acting in critical situations and say, yes, we needed this?
Yes,
union.
We are coming to that. I just wanted to give you that, the analogy of Lenin, Nkrumah, and Marx, Lenin, and Nkrumah. Mm. So Nkrumah wrote his own treatise, which was neocolonialism, the last stage of capitalism. Mm. The last stage of capitalism. Now, according to Nkrumah, once physical colonialism had left, then colonialism got mutated, like you have a virus gets mutated. So now colonialism changed shape. It returned as
neocolonialism.
And what was neocolonialism? Neocolonialism is what some African nationalists today call paper independence. You have a country with a national anthem, with a flag, with all the instruments of state.
With a black president.
With, yes, and black ministers and military officers. But with an economy controlled by foreigners. Mm. What many political economists call what they have termed it that Africans produce what they do not consume and consume what they do not produce. What they mean is that we produce raw material, all minerals,
but we don't consume them.
And yet we export them in raw form to what are called metropolitan countries. That time it was the Western countries. Now you can even add the East, because China and so on have also come in. So we export wholesale raw materials, and in return, get manufactured goods. I can see that suit you are wearing came from our own, I don't know, cotton, or whatever. The shoes from our own leather. And maybe the leather was sold for about, they say $1, but when the shoe returns, it's around $10 or more. So in other words, African countries are being fleeced. We produce the raw materials, which sometimes we process up to a certain stage, and then they are taken.
To add value where they are.
To add value in inverted commas, because at times the value they add is 10%. 90% is done here, using our labor, using our electricity, our water, our everything. But they take it there to add value. And then there are people get jobs.
In that process of adding value.
There are people get taxes. There are people get more. They
get more than actually we do.
Yeah, that's what in the Bible, they say reaping where you have not sown. These people reap where they have not sown.
Major David retired. I want you to tackle the issue of the African Union. Have you ever seen it acting and say, we truly needed this?
The African Union. Right from the East African...
The African Union, from the foundation.
Or AU.
The entire Union.
Okay, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Because it's the same organization.
Yes, that's true. Same organization. But
different, maybe.
Oh, yes, it has done a lot, by the way. What has it done? Remember, when it was formed, it had 32 members.
Members.
Today, it has 55.
So would you call decolonization of
that is
the
greatest success.
Success?
The greatest success of the African Union is decolonization, truly. Decolonization is African Union's greatest success. Of course, the African Union got allies. We cannot run away from facts. One of our greatest allies in decolonization, the truth being told,
North Korea.
Was the Soviet Union.
North Korea.
The Soviet Union. The Soviet Union Even these, you talk of North Korea and Cuba, came in as satellites of the Soviet Union during the time of what is called proxy wars with the United States. But the Soviet Union played a very big role in
decolonization.
Again, it is like the United States. We remember when we were talking about that time of the Marshall Plan. I don't think the Soviet Union loved Africa so much. I don't know whether you have ever read Shakespeare, a play by Julius Caesar. There was somebody called Augustus who said, I think it was Brutus, who said that, not that I loved Caesar less, but Rome most. And here, we can say, not that the Soviet Union loved Africa most, but it loved itself most. Because by supporting African liberation movements, in a way the Soviet Union was weakening the capitalist world, the Western bloc. Really, that's what it was.
It meant that they were using Africa as...
Yeah, to fight their proxy war with the United States, with the West. Yeah, because the moment you weaken your enemy, whatever means you use, then it is to your advantage. And so the Soviet Union...
So by decolonizing Africa, it was strengthening...
Strengthening itself in two ways. One, it weakened the West, because the West used the weapons in these countries, and they lost territory. And of course, the Soviet Union was gained allies, especially in the UN. The Soviet Union had a lot of allies. In fact, during UN vote, the Soviet Union had a lot of support. Even now, you saw it. Russia, the other time when the United States wanted African countries to condemn Russia, they did not get the numbers they had anticipated. And this is historical, because Russia supported the African liberation struggle. In fact, countries, the former Portuguese colonies, owe a lot to Russia or Soviet Union then. Zimbabwe was getting help from former Soviet Union, and to some extent, China. And so, the Eastern Bloc did a lot to help Africa, and plus some of the non-aligned countries like Yugoslavia.
That is one taken. Secondly, yes.
So decolonization is given.
Yes.
Then giving Africa a voice in the international arena. You see, this bloc of 55, or let's say it was 32 then. And the UN had about, I don't know that time, the membership, but it was not so many also, because today the UN has 194.
94.
So that time it must have been maybe around 160 or whatever it was. There was this African bloc of 32, and normally the Africans voted as a bloc.
Yes.
So they gave Africa a voice. And actually, African issues came to be hard. We may look at it, they could not achieve much in terms of physical achievement.
But in terms
of psychological achievement.
And the presence.
African presence. Well, of course, Africa had one big problem. And this was what they call distortion. There was a lot of distortion in Africa. We were so much attached to our former colonial masters that we could not do anything
without
their input, more or less. Look, here was Africa, which could not manufacture even weapons, not even small rifles. Even today, how many countries in Africa manufacture this AK-47, something like that, the rifle we normally use? You can count them, by the way.
Egypt, Sudan.
Uganda now is one of them. I think Tanzania, Ethiopia, yes. But they are not many. But even then, even if you were to say we manufacture, how much do we owe? What is the size and shape and quality?
Quantity and quantities.
Compared to, say, China or the Soviet Union or the United States or Europe. So in other words, the kind of arms or weapons we manufacture are only to meet our own small little wars.
But certainly, in fact, one of the Agenda 2063 was, yes, to silence the gun on the African continent.
Yes.
Today, literally all African countries, mostly a half of the countries, are at war. Not war with anyone else, but Africans are fighting Africans.
Half maybe
and
not.
And how would you
half
really,
maybe not.
How would you credit?
Yes.
You know, the African Union. And how would you give credit to an organization that has failed to silence the gun for the last 60 years?
Well, I think the African Union has really mediated in a lot of these conflicts. I'll give you examples. I told you Nyerere and Idi Amin could not see eye to eye. It was the African Union, at least, which temporarily brought them together in 1973. Under the chairmanship of Siad Barre of Somalia. Okay? That was one. There was one time a dispute between Kenya and Somalia, which was also mediated by the African Union.
But that rivalry is still there.
Well, you cannot remove those rivalries because some of them are historical. You know, many of the African issues are as a result of colonialism. I'll give you an example of Somalia. What you call Somalia today is just a small portion of what Somalia would be if you got all Somalis into one territory. There is what is called the Ogaden, which traverses three countries, Ethiopia, Kenya, and Somalia. And there are Somalis in those areas. So there will always be a conflict over Ogaden because you have the Somalis are in the diaspora, even in Africa. That's one example. You have the issue of, even in our own Uganda, by the way, Rwandans.
Yes.
You have Banyarwanda, okay, let's call them Banyarwanda. You have Banyarwanda in Congo. You have Banyarwanda in Uganda. You have Banyarwanda in Tanzania. You have Banyarwanda in Rwanda.
In Burundi.
And Burundi, okay, the Burundi are really Banyarwanda. So, and each of these, in fact, I wish you could listen to what Mwalimu Nyerere said. At one time, when Congo wanted to send away the Banyamulenge, Nyerere said, okay, fine. If you are going to send away the Banyamulenge, that you don't like the people, are you also going to send their land? You see, if you got what is called Kisoro today, the people of Kisoro, truly, ethnically, are Banyarwanda in Uganda. When you go to Ntungamo, there is a big chunk of Banyarwanda. In DRC, Eastern DRC, Masisi and so on, Banyarwanda. You go down south, Uvira, Kalemi, yes, those are the so-called Banyamulenge. And so, because these communities were divided up, there is always bound to be conflict, especially cross-border area. You have the Samia in Uganda and Samia in Kenya. Teso in Uganda, Teso in Kenya. All these cross-border ethnic groups. Then now between Uganda and Sudan. And so because of those, but to the credit of the African Union, one thing which the African Union did, which was a master stroke, I might say, was right from the outset to declare respect for the boundaries as they existed at the time of independence. That was really a master stroke. Because whoever attempts to create boundaries is referred to that. When Amin tried to take over Kagera in Tanzania, of course he was against international law.
Mm.
Any country, that's why Somalia now cannot go claiming Ogaden from Ethiopia, from Kenya, because it was agreed from the outset that colonial boundaries should be respected as they were.
At the time of independence.
At the time of independence.
We have 5 minutes to wind up this major retired. But also, African Union seems to be doing nothing regarding the debt distressing on the continent.
African debt.
African debt.
Yeah, that's true.
And certainly we expected them to guide their member states, not to borrow what they can as well pay back. And certainly it is called a debt trap.
The debt trap, yes. Well, the debt trap, at first, the debt trap was from the West. The IMF and World Bank and then individual countries, bilateral debts. But now we have a new debt trap from, in particular, China. I think African countries are quite indebted to China. Mm-hmm. Now, this debt trap is, I think it's a capitalist way of doing things. And I like to quote a lot from the Bible. If you look, the wisdom, no, the Proverbs of Solomon. Solomon said, when you are invited to a rich man's table, do not be fooled. He will say, take more, take more. He doesn't mean it. He wants you to eat more and drink more, and then you get drunk and collapse. And this is exactly what the what the advanced countries are doing. They will induce you. China has formed a bank, the Exim Bank, to to give loans to Africa. If you notice how much we are indebted to China, it is really great. And yet, when you look at our wealth, at least our potential wealth, all these Africa, look at the example of the DRC. The DRC is one of the richest countries that God created in terms of natural resources. There's not a resource almost that they don't have. Minerals of all types. Uranium even included, coltan, columbite tantalite, diamonds, gold, call it. Mbujimayi is called the diamond capital of the world. There's gold everywhere. And yet, when you then you have agricultural potential. DRC has some of the best arable land anywhere in the world.
Mm-hmm.
And then timber, the best timber. And yet, DRC is one of the poorest countries in the world. One of the poorest. When you go to DRC, I wish you could visit DRC.
I've visited it before.
You have.
Mm.
You'll find people eating maggots.
Yeah.
I'm glad you saw. Maggots. Here you will run away from a maggot, but there they eat chimpanzees, they eat all this. It's not that they love them. It's because the people. What did they do to DRC? People spent most of their time in music.
Uh-huh.
And when Mobutu came, he continued the colonial legacy. There are no roads.
Mm.
To travel in DRC, you don't have to move on water. Fortunately, they have a lot of navigable rivers. Of course, air is for the rich.
Mm.
And there is your DRC. Sitting on plenty.
On wealth.
On wealth, and yet you live in absolute poverty.
And I don't think we shall actually forgive the African Union for failing to bring stability.
Well,
to
the African Union has set Agenda 2063, which is talking about all this, which is very good. It is saying, okay, we still have now, how many years? 63.
63, this is 23, about 40?
40 years.
Mm.
And I know that's almost your age.
Mm-hmm.
So that that 40 years is good enough for African Union to put right what didn't go right. So we need not, of course, there were a few things. But by the way, decolonization was quite hard because we had a lot of drawback.
And it is still going on.
And it's still going on. And then And then we also had people who came in and messed us up. People like Idi Amin, who didn't know what to do. People like Jean Bedel Bokassa. People like, you know, a lot of these fellows who took over power when they didn't even know what to do with power. And even today, the African Union is still having a problem of coups in Africa. Mali, Burkina Faso, Sudan, where there's even a civil war. All these factors. But I believe the African Union is trying its best. And I told you last time, and I still predict that it will be the African Union and IGAD
to find
to resolve
the Sudan question. All right, thank you so much for that. Yeah. Those wonderful insights. And of course, we want to take a short break. When we return, we have a conversation, female musicians, the challenges female musicians are finding in the industry. Maestro Amit is sitting down with Kappa Cut, and that conversation is coming up after this very short break. A very good morning.
Thank you.
Dear esteemed viewer, this is to inform you that starting 17th, your favorite soap, Bahum Began,